There's a lot of great things happening at Tennessee Athletics.
I believe this city is going to be upside down tonight.
Season-long party continues at Rocky Top.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to Everything Orange. Today, our guest is a senior on the men's tennis team who has left his mark on the program. Currently, his record this season in singles and doubles sits at 46-9, while going undefeated in singles in the SEC this season, winning 10 matches. As of now, he holds his highest singles ranking in the nation, coming in at number 2 this season, and the men's team is currently ranked 6th nationally. He's got a lot of love for this program and the people he's met along the way on Rocky Top, and will be leaving behind big shoes to fill after this season wraps up. So please welcome to the Everything Orange podcast, Johannus Monday. Johannus Monday, thanks so much for joining the Everything Orange podcast. Yeah. This is huge. This is so exciting. We just talked before we started recording, and everyone around here calls you Johannus. Yep. Mom, if you're listening, we know that it's not Joe, but that's the nickname that everyone gave you. And then on top of that, everyone calls you Jomo. So we wanted Mom to know that Johannus coming on the podcast today. You're in your senior year. This is crazy. Did it come really fast for you?
Honestly, it's gone too quick. I mean... As a freshman, I was like, wow, these 4 years are going to last long. I don't know if I'm going to make it, but now I'm here, it's gone by too quickly. Yeah. And I've loved every second.
Are you getting a little sentimental as things are starting to wrap up, like the regular season and the SEC tournament?
Yeah, honestly, I'm not a very sentimental person usually, but
yeah.
I was on the phone to my mom the other day and telling her how honestly sad I am that it's coming to an end.
Aww.
So yeah.
What are you going to like remember or miss the most about this college experience? Because it's so different than when you're out as a professional solo, you know, on your own, but you have this team behind you in college.
Well, I mean, I'm gonna miss a lot. I think honestly competing as a team, because in tennis it's such an individual sport, and it's a very different feeling because you're not just playing for yourself, you're playing for your teammates, the coaches, the fans, the university. So it's such a great pressure and a privilege to play for something bigger than yourself.
What's the biggest surprise that's come along the way these past 4 years that, looking back when you were a freshman, you would have never dreamed or believed that it would happen?
Honestly, I think how well I've done my career. I didn't think I would ever achieve some of the goals I've achieved. And yeah, I just never thought it would happen, to be honest.
That makes me so emotional in the best way, because a huge announcement just came out, Joe. But by the time that this podcast airs, it'll be a couple days old news. But we just found out last night, and it's going out this afternoon, that you were announced the SEC Player of the Year. And not only this year, but back-to-back years, because you won it last season. When you heard the news, what were your thoughts?
Honestly, very proud, because like I said to you, I mean, I never thought stuff like that was going to be part of my college career, and now it's a natural reality. It does honestly mean a lot to me, and I'm very proud of it.
Yeah, did you call your mom as soon as you heard the news? What did
she
say?
Literally, I got the text from Matt, and I was having dinner with one of the guys, and the first thing I did was call my mom and tell her. It was like 1 a.m.
And I
woke her up, but yeah, she was happy.
Oh, that's so sweet. Well, in the conference, it's only happened 4 times, so you're really etching your name into history, and it's very exciting. We're so proud of you, and we kind of have like a little bit of a celebration that we wanted to give you.
Oh, no.
Well, I'm going to lead the singing, but in the tune Happy Birthday, happy SEC player to Johannus.
Wow. That means a lot. Thank you.
Happy SEC player to Johannus. Happy SEC player to Johannus. Happy SEC player to you.
Thank you. That's a nice surprise. Thank you.
We're so proud of you.
I do appreciate
it. This is so exciting. We're going into the postseason. It's going to be a lot in terms of team and individual and double stuff coming up here soon. First, it starts with the team, though. As of Monday, so it'll be a couple days from now, but when the podcast airs, it'll be a couple days that the announcement came out about the selection show. And then the first and second rounds get underway next weekend. We're top 10 in the country, so we're gonna host regionals. We do know that for sure, but we don't know who we're playing just yet. But regardless, how excited are you to have another opportunity at home to continue a postseason run?
I mean, I think it's so important playing at home. I mean, it's such a huge advantage. So I'm excited. I mean, again, I get to have another battle with the guys and be next to them. So it means a lot to me.
Having it at home too, you said it is a huge advantage. We know that. In what ways is it going to help to have it at home on a court that you know so well in front of a fan base that really comes out and supports you guys?
Yeah, I mean, I think in terms of confidence, we haven't lost a home match this year. So we're high on confidence at home. I think playing in front of the fans, we always play better because I think it means a little bit more when we play in front of the fans and we don't have to travel. I honestly think that's a huge thing. I mean, where we can get some good rest, we don't have to fly anywhere. So all those little things do add up.
Coming off of the SEC tournament, how the situation unfolded, does that have a chip on y'all's shoulder to come out here and just have a, not a revenge tour, but want to come out and play your game this coming up weekend?
Yeah, I mean, honestly, the last few weeks has been tough. We had a chance to win the regular season and it came down to us or Kentucky, and we lost to Kentucky in the last day, which was left a very sour note in our mind. And then the week after, we had high hopes for the SEC tournament, and that didn't fulfill our expectations. But I think we can all use it as motivation for the main prize in college tennis, which is to win a national championship.
Yeah, absolutely. For you, the individual selection will release the Tuesday following Monday's team selection show, and then individual singles start May 20th and doubles on May 21st. What are you looking forward to with the opportunity with singles?
To try and win a national championship.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Period. Mic drop.
Period.
That's
yep.
it. Yes.
That's my plan.
Let's talk and kind of revisit freshman year to senior year, because the freshman season was, I don't know, did it come as a surprise to you? Because the accolades, when I went through them all and I was just rattling them off, 7 SEC Freshman of the Week honors. You helped lead Tennessee to its first SEC title of any kind for men's tennis since 2010. You were the 2021 SEC All-Freshman Team and All-SEC First Team and the 2021 Freshman of the Year. Yeah. That was a huge season for you. What do you remember about it? And in terms of just betting on yourself and having nothing to lose coming from across the pond.
You know, what I remember is a very, very difficult fall in terms of how hard I worked, how much the coaches pushed me, how I had to adapt to college tennis and college life. It was tough. I mean, I loved every second, but I put in some long hours and it was painful.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that paid off in the spring, and I think it shows with those accolades.
Clearly it paid off. This is like an insane roster of all these accomplishments that you had your freshman year. Your record was also, I have to just say, like 32-9, huge for your freshman year. What were some of the biggest challenges, but also great learning lessons that came out of that freshman season for you?
I think honestly the biggest challenge, and I've said this before, was belief. Mm-hmm. I mean, coming into college, I didn't believe in my capabilities, let's say, but the coaches tried to instill that into me, and I think that's one of the things that I learned after my freshman year, was to truly believe in myself. And honestly, that's still something I struggle with, even now, even after all my successes. Like, we all struggle with it, but yeah, I think that's the main thing I learned, was to try and believe in yourself.
One of the things so for people who don't know that are listening, I was the videographer for the men's tennis team last season. So I got to travel with you guys and be around the courts a lot and get to know you, Angel, and Sean in particular very well. And you're one of the most quiet, modest guys on the court. You stay in your lane. You're not a loud enthusiast in terms of cheering on the court. You're just a mild guy sweeping these guys on the court. Yeah. It's just like another day of work for Joe. But what is the self-talk that you're having to yourself in terms of keeping that belief going? Because I just see you so reserved and so quiet, but I know you're there and you're talking to yourself and you're getting yourself psyched up for these moments.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, it's a battle. I mean, in my mind, there's that positive side and the negative side like we all have, but I work with Dr. Joe, the sports psychologist.
Yes.
Religiously, I see him probably more than he wants to see me. But I mean, the tools that I learn from him and I work with him, I use in my matches, and I do honestly feel like that really does help. So
yeah, and in terms of getting over those mountaintops when you might be down a set or when this point is so big in terms to close out things in those moments, what are you saying to yourself? How are you coaching yourself in those moments?
I think, honestly, I try and find something I can believe in. Like, honestly, one of the things Joe and I worked on it. It might sound silly, was we have like this flow chart, and we go through things that I try and believe in. Is if I can beat this guy, if I believe I can beat him, then great. But if I don't believe him, then we go down to the next thing. Can I win a set? And we went all the way down to, do I believe I can tie my shoelace? Literally. And I just, every match I go through that, and I stop why I believe. Sometimes it's higher than others, and some days it's lower, but at least I have something to believe in, and that's what I try and do.
That is one of the coolest things I've ever heard on the podcast. Just like such a unique perspective to an athlete and their sport. Because like you said, that list, you might be down at the very bottom, and it might be stepping on the court and tying your shoelace that day. But other days it might be, oh, I know I am capable of beating the guy across the net from me. That is such an interesting perspective. Yep. I love that. So fast forward, we started out freshman season, going all the way to now senior year. 26-2, Joe.
Yep.
That's incredible. You went undefeated in singles matches in the SEC, won 10 straight. You were named the 2024 SEC All-Tournament Team and, like we just mentioned, back-to-back SEC Player of the Year awards. I know after Wimbledon and this summer that you had, it was an option to either go pro or to come back to college. But after all that you've accomplished this season, what stands out to you the most about it?
You know, the thing that stands out the most is when you said my record is 26-2, it's the two losses that pained me the most, because I mean, I think I'm a bit of a perfectionist, and I know I've had some good results this year, but that's the two things that stand out to me, which isn't maybe the best thing, but that's just how I feel.
I feel like that's a champion's mindset. It's never the wins. It's never necessarily giving yourself the credit when credit's due. It's where can I improve? Where can I grow? And that's what I'm going to focus on. The rest is just checking boxes.
I mean, after every match, win or lose, I always try and I write down in my journal on my phone things I did well, things I can do better, because honestly, I'm always looking to try and improve. And I think that's one of my main strengths. And that's one of my reasons for success, is because I'm never really happy with what I've done. I always want to try and achieve a little more, because again, working with Joe, the first day we met was, we defined my goal in tennis, and that wasn't to be SEC Player of the Year or number one in the country or whatever. It was to just try and master the game of tennis and fulfill my potential, and that's what I'm trying to work towards.
I do want to give your flowers, though, because you've had incredible accomplishments come along the way this season as well. March 26th, you had your 50th win over a ranked opponent. And like I said, 10 of those wins came from top 10 ranked opponents as well. April 7th was your 100th career singles win. Yep. And April 16th, you were ranked number 2 in the nation, your highest singles ranking. Yep. When I say those, and I know they're all positives, there's no negatives you can point out to me this time. What is feels like your biggest accomplishment? And it doesn't even have to be on this list, but what has come out of this season that you're most proud of?
Honestly, I think not losing at home as a team. Like, I think that means a lot to me, because we have a good fan base who come out and watches every single match. And it honestly, when I've lost at home in the past, it pains me more, because all these fans have come out to cheer us on and we've not got it through the line. So I'm very proud that I've not had to experience that feeling this year.
Yeah, it's so much fun over there. And like you said, it's huge to have that at home, because you can celebrate it as a team and then you can also share in the celebration with the fans. That's amazing. One of those wins came on senior day, which is a really special day for you in particular, because you had finished out all 4 of your years here at Tennessee. Yep. And your mom came all the way from England to celebrate with you. So tell me, she had never been to Knoxville before.
Nope, she's never been to America. I don't think she's flown since like the 1990s. She hates flying. Yep,
she
hates
it. That flight's not long, or not short either. It's a long flight.
9 hours with tough turbulence it was for her.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, she didn't like it.
That's insane. But and she even told you said that she was even like, Joe, I'm not gonna come. I don't know if I'm gonna come.
No, I mean, I was telling her, because obviously I was planning it and trying to figure out when she's coming
logistics,
here.
I
had to tell her. I wanted to surprise her firstly, but I knew if I surprised her a week before, she wasn't gonna come.
Right. So she had to mentally prepare for it.
I told her months in advance, and every day I was getting sent TikToks of planes like with Boeing and not going well. She's like, I'm not coming.
I'm not doing
it. But she finally did, because she loves me so much. So
absolutely. So when she did land and she got to see America for the first time too, because she'd never been to America, what were some of her first thoughts when she landed?
How big it is. I mean, she loved it. I mean, she said the people, as soon as she got off the plane from England, that the people were so nice greeting her. And yeah, she loved her time here. It was very special.
How long was she here?
10 days.
Okay.
Honestly, for my mom, she wants to see like the little things, where I live, where I train, meet everybody. That's the most important thing for her.
Where you go get your groceries out, you go on a Friday night to grab late night snacks. We got the chance to meet her down in the studio. I'm sure the studio was like a really cool spot for her to see all the interviews where we make your highlight videos, like things like that too. So it was so nice getting to meet her. Good. She's lovely.
She is.
For her though, did she even get to see your match? Because that was a debatable talking point when you came down to the studio.
Yeah, she didn't. But that's honestly, I mean...
That's normal.
That's kind of on me. I mean, since I was 10, I mean, when I used to play, she used to get so nervous watching me. And I used to get so nervous her watching me as well.
Okay.
So we just decided that, look, it's probably best you don't watch me. And I'll just call you after the result and I'll tell you, I won or I lost. And it's just been a thing ever since. And it was just the same routine because we didn't want to jinx it.
Right. So let me map this out for people. She's there on the court celebrating you, taking the photo. You have the shirt, Johannus Monday at the bottom. And then she goes into the parking lot and leaves. Does she stay in the parking lot?
No, she goes for a walk. And then I call her, tell her I'm done. Then she comes back and comes with me. Yeah, literally. Yeah.
Because I know she was even talking about how she might watch it in the car, like literally car reversed and like back to the courts watching it on her phone, but she didn't even watch it. She wanted to walk around campus.
No, because she knows that I have such a good eye for spotting her. I mean, when I was younger, I would spot her from a mile away and I'd get not happy with her.
No.
So she didn't want to chance it.
You could even feel it. Like a sixth sense for you you're like, mom's watching. Yeah. This is not okay.
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
It is.
She still came all the way from England to support you. Yeah. Nonetheless, even though she didn't get to actually watch you play, which cracks me up. I cannot believe that.
I do feel bad a little bit. And I mean, a lot of people on this podcast listening are going to be like, well,
what the heck?
Yeah.
But it's been like how you guys operate.
It is how
you guys have done it. And you wouldn't want it any other way. It'd be
strange.
It'd be weird.
Yep.
Yeah, that's fine. Okay, so without getting too sappy with the end of the season upon us, there are a lot of lasts and a lot of moments that I'm sure you're going to look back on and wish you could have one more opportunity to be coached by your coaches or to celebrate a team win with the guys. In terms of your coaches, you've had James and Woody for the past 4 years. What has their mentorship, their support on the court, cheering you on, meant to you?
Honestly, everything. I mean, they've both been like a father figure to me, and that means a lot to me because of my upbringing and stuff. But yeah, they mean the world to me, and some of the things they've done for me is beyond what a coach does for their guys, and they honestly hold a special place in my heart. And that's one of the reasons why every time I go on the match court, I want to win so badly, not just for myself and the teammates, but also for them, because they put so much trust into me because I wasn't a good recruit coming into college, and they put a lot of faith into me that it would work out, and I just hope I've repaid that.
I think you have, Joe. Yep. I don't want to speak for them, but I think they would say it. The guys that, you know, were on the team when you were a freshman and have watched you come through this program would say it, that you've exceeded everyone's expectations, but not just by luck, but because of your hard work. So I do believe that that's true. And you're also the only guy from your recruiting class that is still here that went through all 4 years here at Tennessee. And I know there's, you know, guys that have come before you, that guys that are after you, but what are you going to miss the most about that team camaraderie, having, you know, all these experiences with the new guys, the old ones, and that have since gone on and do great things?
Yeah, I mean, honestly, I was thinking that this morning, because today we had weights at 6 a.m., which is not the most fun, but I was seeing this today, like, wow, this could be one of my last weight sessions with the guys, and I'm like, wow, what I would do to have those 4 years back and be going to weights at 6 a.m., it's honestly the little things, like going through the tough times with the guys, because it makes us stronger and it makes us closer. So those are the things that I'm going to miss the most.
Mm-hmm. I feel like that's what every athlete says after the fact, but I'm glad you're realizing it in the moment, that it's like, man, my alarm's going off at 5 a.m. This sucks, but I'm not going to be doing it with these guys ever again.
No,
so you got to cherish it all. In terms of how special, too, it's been for you to play with the ones who've come before you and the ones after you, what do those guys mean to you?
Everything. They're my family. I mean, every single one of them. I stay in touch with them all the time, and I care a lot about them. If they ever need anything, I'm there for them. And then I feel the same. I hope they feel the same way about me if I ever need anything, they're going to be there for me. So we're family. It's not just teammates or friends. It's family for most of us.
I feel like that's such an important note to hit on too for you guys, because you guys come from all different corners of the world. It's so many cultures meshing, so many different backgrounds coming together. But this isn't the last time that y'all will see each other. There will be other international competitions where you're going to be training together or meeting each other on the court even. So it's exciting to know that the brotherhood between you guys doesn't end once your time
is up. I don't think it ever will.
Yeah.
Until our last days, it'll be there, yeah.
Being one of the vets of this team too, what has it meant to you to be that figure that guys can look up to and be like, I want to be like Joe, I want to have a legacy and an impact left on Tennessee like he has?
Yeah. I mean, honestly, I haven't really thought about it. I mean, I just try and help the guys because honestly, I want to win. Yeah. And I feel like it's kind of my job because I've been through those experiences. And I know because of my accolades, I have that people look up to me and respect me. So I have that authority figure and I can say stuff to them that they might not always want to hear, but I think they respect what I say. So that's kind of been my job for this year, is to try and lead the guys and point them in the right direction, which it was something that I really tried to put a lot of emphasis on this season.
Yeah, especially with, like you mentioned, the way that this season has unfolded towards the end. That's not easy.
No.
It's not an easy position for them to be in, young and experiencing something like that, but also for you to have to step into this new role and get everybody back on track, because the season is not done yet. There's still work to be done.
Well, this is the main part of the season. I mean, in college tennis, everybody says it's not what you do from January to April, it's what you do in May. That's all that matters. And May's fast approaching, so it's time to go.
What's one of the big pieces of advice that you've tried to hit home with these guys over the last week or so heading into NCAAs next week?
Stay positive. I think it's easy to dwell on the negatives and stuff, and I do that as well, but I think that's something I've learned as I've got older, to try and remain positive no matter what happens. And that's what I've tried to tell the guys, is look, we've got a good shot, let's stay positive, take it one at a time and keep the belief.
Now, coming up, because you know this will be the end of the road for you once the season comes to a close, and I don't want to get too far ahead and have you thinking about that just yet, because there is a lot of work that you and everybody else on the team still want to do. However, Wimbledon is happening this summer. And for people who don't know, let's revisit last year's Wimbledon, because on short notice, you found out that you'd be playing in Wimbledon singles in the qualifying tournament, your first ever appearance in one of the big four. And then not only did you qualify for singles, but you and TCU's Jacob Fernley made the main draw for doubles after winning the Nottingham Cup just a couple weeks prior to it. So it was like everything happening all at once. In this first exciting experience for you, you had no easing into it. It was just like, okay, I'm here and I'm doing it all. How did that experience over the summer help you grow coming into this season and then also preparing for a summer like it ahead?
Yeah, I mean, I think it helped with confidence. I mean, I played some of the best guys in the world and I was right there with them going toe to toe. And that fills you with confidence, of course. So I've tried to use that experience in college because I think it's important, but also, I mean, those few weeks I tried to just enjoy them, because you never know if you're going to get to play it again. I mean, and it was honestly some of the best weeks of my life. I loved it so much. So
having that experience and wanting to get back there, what does the off season look like for you wanting to return there this summer?
Yeah, well, I think honestly, I mean, it all depends on how well I finish in college.
Okay.
I mean, and that's just my focus, because I think you can look too far down the road and you can forget what's in front of you. So my responsibility is to try and get a little better today, then try and prepare myself for the team event, then individuals, and then we'll see what happens after then.
Okay, good. Just so everybody again at home listening knows, you're kind of doing pretty well in terms of individual success, because you're number two in the country.
Yep.
No big deal. Number two in the country nationally. Huge deal. So you set yourself up really well for success through the postseason and what's to come after that. So it's all very exciting for you. But like, what's next for Joe? Are we diving full into professional tennis?
Yep.
Okay.
100%.
Succeed in.
It's my job. In my opinion, yeah, it's my job.
Yes, yes. Okay, so are we going to go home to England and train? What does the next couple months post-college look like for you?
Yeah, no, that's a good question. I think for me, I mean, I've had a lot of people's opinions on this and not many people agree, but at the end of the day, it's my tennis and I have to do what's best for me. And I think after the season, I think I need to stay in Knoxville and train because for me, there's things I need to get better at and work on, which I have written down in my phone. And it's a long list, so I might not be able to tick them off, but I want to take at least a few off. And I want to experience the heat as well, because I know in Knoxville it gets hot and tennis is, you can play in some hot conditions. So I want to try and acclimatize to that before I go out and play. But then after that, I'll be competing all around the world, trying to climb up the rankings and get to the Grand Slams.
I'm glad you're doing what you think is best for you. At the end of the day, no one knows you better than yourself. So it's good that you're able to come to peace and to terms with that decision. And that's really exciting that you're going to still be in Knoxville. You don't have to entirely say bye to Tennessee and Knoxville just yet.
Well, maybe that's the main reason I want to be, because I don't want to say bye.
Right. So. And if you have the opportunity, why not take it for just a little bit longer? When you start going and traveling internationally more, now that mom has made that first big flight, is she going to try to travel to more? Is it on her radar?
Maybe, but she won't be watching. So I don't know if there's much point in her coming. So
that's true. It's just, she want to like manage you? Does she want to be a part of the Johannus team in any way?
No, she wants to be mom. My mom, I mean, she doesn't know much about tennis. I mean, and that's how we operate. All she cares about, in honesty, is that I try my best. I'm a good person and I'm respectful. She doesn't know about the forehands or the back, and she leaves that to the coaches because she trusts them and she trusts me. So that's our relationship.
I feel like that's very rare in today's sport culture. I feel like the parents are stories, the headlines of the brawls that happen at soccer matches and the parents getting into it at football games and even the coaches too. So it's so refreshing to hear that your mom's like, this is your thing. You're also an adult and you can handle your business and your relationships. So I'm going to let you manage that. And I'm just going to be your cheerleader in the corner. Also, are you, my last question on that same topic, are you wanting to move back home and get some time at home to kind of refresh and be around family and friends, or is it still pretty much like full steam ahead with training and competing?
Full steam ahead. I mean, I don't know why I'm going to base myself. I've got a few options in
Europe,
some in England. But honestly, I want to stay in Tennessee. I want to try and train here as long as I can, because it's my home right now. And I don't want to give that up just yet.
Right. You spent the past 4 years here. I mean, that's like that's a hard move to transition anywhere after you've been so comfortable and in a routine here for so long. And also, correct me if I'm wrong, but some of the guys too, some of the former guys still come back and train here. So you also have like a community here that is around you.
Like I said, Elliot, it's family. So we can always come back.
Exactly. Yep. You don't always leave for good. Okay. I want to talk about some fun things now too.
Okay.
Here, you're a big Netflix guru. You spend a lot of your free time watching Netflix. Is that true?
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Are you shows or movies?
Shows. Don't like movies.
Don't you? No. Do you have the attention span for
no,
movies?
No, my attention span's short. So when I'm watching TV shows, I watch it for 15 minutes and I go do something else, then another 15.
Come back to it. Okay. What show are you binging right now?
Ooh, Breaking Bad.
Okay. Yep. That's a long
Tell me about it.
For you, that's a commitment.
It is a big commitment. I've been going. My first time I watched it was the day before we played TCU, which was in January.
Oh my gosh! And you're still on it.
Yep, still going.
Would you recommend it? Like, are you liking it so far?
Oh, amazing! I mean, I feel like a lot of people have watched it. And
yeah, I've always heard great things about it. I just can't commit to the time, like you said, because it's such a long show. Okay, what other Netflix shows would you recommend that have been on your top list?
I mean, Prison Break. I love Prison Break.
I feel like those go hand in hand. It's Breaking Bad and Prison Break.
Great show.
Okay.
Money Heist. I love that. But not everybody likes it because it's dubbed from Spanish to English.
Oh, okay. So there's like the translation and the words don't match.
But for me, I don't mind. Okay. And then, I mean, it's a lot. I mean, I like comedies. There's one comedy movie I do like. It's called The Week Of with Kevin Hart.
Okay.
Very good.
I haven't seen it.
I watch it a lot. That's like my go-to movie if I want cheering
up. You need a good laugh. Yeah. You just put that on in the background. Yeah. Okay, good. I'm watching Gilmore Girls right now.
My mom's watching that as well. So
I was gonna say our tastes in Netflix don't quite align, but somebody out there can relate to it. And it's your mom.
That's great. Yeah.
I wonder what she's on, because I just got to season 5 and it got wild. So you'll have to tell her to like tell me what her updates are and what she thinks of the show, because it's so good. And then I also like the reality TV shows. So I've watched like Selling Sunsets and what's the other one? Buying Beverly Hills, all the drama. It's just so good. So I'm like, I have my like commitment show. And then like you kind of said, I have my fun show where like I don't need to fully pay attention to what's going on. That's my reality TV trash. Like I just put that on in the background sometimes. I'll do dishes, laundry, whatever.
No, I like that. I mean, the one reality show I used to like was Love Island.
Oh!
I was a big Love Island fan, yeah. Yeah, I mean, so when I was, so I went to boarding school when I was 13 and until I was 18. And it was all boys boarding school. So every night at 9 p.m., we'd watch Love Island. All six of us on one big TV.
That is
hilarious.
And
it got wild. It was good times. But that's a commitment as well. I mean, every day for like 3 months.
Right.
Yeah, we were committed. Six
that
of us guys
hilarious.
Committed.
That is hilarious. You guys, what were like, were you guys like cheering on? Did you have like people you were rooting for?
Oh, yes. That's we so were invested. Yeah,
you were invested.
Yeah,
have you tried your hand in like American Love, like The Bachelor?
No.
No?
No. You're not going to get me on that, no.
No? No. What is it about Love Island that's, in your opinion, that makes you enjoy it more?
Just the twists and the turns. Mm. It was amazing. I mean,
it gets
and
crazy.
The music as well. I mean, okay. I'm a big music guy.
Yes.
And they would play some good songs.
It was
top tier. Okay. Every time. They didn't miss.
I've watched like one-off like Love Island episodes here and there, especially when it was like new, and I haven't come back to it, but like you're really selling me on it, so I think it's I need good. To give it a try.
Do so. You need to.
Okay, once I finish my Kardashians,
yep.
I'll go to Love Island. Okay, the last thing I have for us, Joe, is I also hear that you're a big New York Times games enthusiast.
Of course. This is my worst one.
So I pulled out the crossword for us from today, April 25th, dear. Thursday, April 25th. And we're going to try to fill it out. I have the answers here too.
Okay,
so,
I'm going to need them.
Okay, so we can like reference. But we're going to try to give it a go before we look at the answers. Okay, I'll say all these out loud before we go through them and try to do them. Okay, one across is move like a pendulum. Having six across, having an established key musically. Number seven across, up and fully caffeinated, say. Eight, tablecloth material, and then nine, English City in West Yorkshire. You should know that. What are the odds?
If I don't, that's
not
good
bad.
Of me. It is.
Should we start there? Do you want to have some time to think about that one?
The thing is, it could be a lot. It could be
okay,
a lot.
Okay, so we should
ones,
fill out the other ones to see where it gets us. Okay.
This is actually why I live, like pretty much.
You're so close to
I'm
it.
In Yorkshire, like one hour.
Okay, you can't disappoint all of your hometown
people. I do feel
people.
Pressure.
Yeah, this is a big moment for you, so... Take a second, okay?
Yeah, I will.
Okay. Move like a pendulum. Swing.
See, that's what I was...
Okay,
I was seeing the same.
Okay, let's put that in just to have it down on paper. Swing. Five across. This is the mini one for people at home who aren't watching on YouTube. Okay. Having an established key musically. Pitch.
Sure.
Pitch.
That's what I was... I had no idea. So.
Okay.
But
that sounds right. Anybody in the room have any? No? Cool. Okay. I'm going to go with pitch.
Yeah. It's okay.
We'll come back to it.
It's definitely not it.
I don't think that's it.
Okay. We'll keep going.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Up and fully caffeinated, say. Up and fully caffeinated. Awake? I feel like, I feel like somebody in the audience needs to have, here, Allison. Yeah, you have it. The answers and you can kind of give us
We are struggling, so give us some clues.
Yeah. We might have just said the answer. Awake? Okay.
Okay.
Nice. Awake.
Well.
I'm
going to
be honest, that one before that, I don't think y'all are going to get it.
Okay, so pitch was not right. Womp womp. Okay. Okay.
Okay.
So, tablecloth material. Linen. Ding, ding, ding.
There you go.
Linen. Okay. It's coming down to your last one, Joe.
Leeds? Is that?
Okay,
there we go.
Yay!
There
good
we go.
Job, Joe! Wait, how do you even spell that?
L-E-E-D-S. Yes.
You should.
I mean, I've not been like helping much, but that's why I stepped in. Yeah. I do feel better about myself.
No,
so.
Literally, the New York Times knew that you were coming on this podcast today and said, let's throw a question there for Joe.
I mean, they needed it. So.
Okay, now I'm just going to scratch out this one that we're going to come back to because those letters aren't right.
It's definitely swing, the first one. Okay.
Swing. Okay.
So it's six across.
So we literally have four of the across ones.
Okay.
So honestly, we can take any of the down ones and just kind of fill in. Okay. The down ones are try
stall.
To...
Okay, so it's...
Which one? Stall?
I think it's stall.
Stall. One down, try to buy some time. Stall. Okay. Yep. Making progress. Two down, exclamation that rhymes with Maui. Wowie! That's... That is hilarious, only because I can see it funny. Like spelled out. Yeah. That is hilarious. Okay, the next one, total wackadoodle. I space A-N-E. Process of elimination. I don't know if I've ever heard this word before.
I'm blanking.
In the buff.
Naked?
Naked. Okay. Okay. And then mountain valleys. It starts with a G. G space E N S.
That's smart writing it down like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, just so we can see just so we can see it out. Mm-hmm. Okay. Glens. I didn't get that on my own, Jeb. They had the L up.
Oh, okay.
you're like what? That's a hard one. I've never heard that word before. Okay, we
need one more.
Literally don't have three down. Totally wackadoodle.
Or six across.
So. Or six across. Okay, so we have T O, and then we don't know that one, and then A L. Having an established key.
S. T.
N. Tonals? I've never heard that word in my life. Okay. Yay.
There we go.
We did it.
We needed some help, but we did it.
We did it. We got there. Joe, I mean, the fact that we were able to pretty much go all the way down, minus that one, like, that's
helped.
Impressive.
It did. That was good. That was good. I feel better about myself now.
Good.
Gonna have a good day, so I got it. Yeah.
We're gonna have a great...
I just need to get Wordle now and then... connections, so.
Oh!
Yeah.
Is that true?
Yeah, I mean.
If you don't get all three of those New York Times puzzles, or which one?
If I don't get Wordle and connections, then I'm like, yeah, so I'm gonna struggle today.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. When, when we lost to South Carolina, I actually didn't get Wordle that day. And I said to myself, this is gonna be a tough day. And it was. So I don't know if I jinxed myself or not, but on the ride back, I was like, yep, I definitely jinxed it. So now I feel a lot of pressure on game days. I feel so much pressure
Get
it. It's more pressure than playing the match. Because if I get it, I'm like, okay, I'll win. But if I don't get it, I'm like, well, I'm in for a battle today. So.
Oh my gosh. Okay, yeah. Well.
But then I got it in two days ago. I was like, wow, it's going to be a great day.
Okay. So which one was that? The Wordle?
The Wordle, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I felt good.
Did you do them yet today?
Not yet. I need to.
All right. When we get on this podcast, we need to do them. We got to figure out if you're going to have a good day. For well, sure. You're SEC Player of the Year, so you better have a dang good
that's
day.
That's true. Yeah, that's true.
Regardless of what happens.
Yeah, that's true. Yep.
Joe, this was so fun. I wish you could co-host the show with me because I feel like we would have so much fun, but you have to go be a professional tennis player, whatever.
Well, we could get more crosswords done, if nothing else. So.
If anything else, we can start our day off with the New York Times.
That's true.
This was so fun. Good luck the rest of the season, and congratulations on an incredible 4 years at Tennessee. We're so proud of you.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Yay! This was so fun. Thanks so much, y'all, for listening to another episode of the Everything Orange podcast. As always, be sure to follow us on all of our Vol Sports platforms so you don't miss out on a single update. But before we go, here's a look at everything going on with Tennessee athletics this upcoming week, starting with tonight. Softball plays game one against Kentucky in Sherry Parker Lee Stadium at 7 p.m., while baseball heads down south to take on the Gators at 7 p.m. in Gainesville. On Friday, softball plays game two against the Wildcats at 6 p.m. in Sherry Parker Lee. Baseball plays game two against Florida at 6:30 on the road. And men's tennis, kicks off regionals on Friday and Saturday at home in Barksdale Stadium. A huge home court advantage, like Joe mentioned just now on the podcast. So please make sure to come out and cheer him and his teammates on. On Saturday, softball and baseball both play their last game in the weekend series, the Lady Vols at 2 p.m. on campus and the Vols at 6:30 in Florida. Also, in addition to the men's tennis team, the women's tennis team will also be kicking off their NCAA regionals on Saturday and Sunday. On Monday, women's golf kicks off their regionals that will be going on through Wednesday. Tuesday, baseball has its midweek game against Queens at 6 p.m. in Lindsey Nelson Stadium. And I cannot believe I am already saying this. The 2024 SEC softball tournament begins. It is so exciting that the postseason is already upon us. I cannot wait to see what all of our spring sports are up to. Well, that's a wrap on Rocky Top. Make sure to tune in next Thursday for another episode of Everything Orange. Bye, y'all.